Morning, ladies and gentlemen. We are running about half an hour against time, as per the new schedule which is worked out for the day. So without further ado, I'll introduce Mr. Gopal Pillai and request him to speak to us. I've decided to give my presentation a skip. Mr. Gopal Pillai, better known to all of us as one of perhaps independent India's best home secretaries ever. And I say this from the outside because we have observed him at very trying times and found that he always was up to speed with all the things that he was entrusted with. Mr. Pillai is an IAS officer from the Kerala cadre and has been a student at Bishop Cotton School, Bangalore, and eventually is an alumnus of the IIT. He has served in many capacities in the Government of India and with greatest distinction as the Home Secretary of India. And he will now give us his view about the security scenario in India as it exists and as was really witnessed by him in the last three or four crucial years, particularly in the post-2611 days. Mr. Pillai.
Thank you, Maruf. Yeah. I have 15 minutes. That's what Maruf told me. First of all, I want to thank Devdatta Naik for his, I think it makes in one sense my task very easy because you understand now why the internal security situation in India is so chaotic. And we say we are in the Kali Yuga, so things are going to only get worse till you're looking for the next avatar of Vishnu to come and solve all your problems. So, I mean, that's one way of looking at the whole situation. But I think the internal security situation in India is going to be, and I've said it very often, it's going to be chaotic, at least, I put it as for at least the next 20, 30 years, three decades. I'll tell you why. If you look at Indian democracy as such, and it's starting from the founding fathers of the constitution, and we really have to understand that in 47, 49, when they drew up the constitution, we had only 12% of our people were literate, and yet they gave everybody universal literacy, something which even most Western countries had not given their population, even when they became free. In countries like America, you've seen the blacks never got vote till over 100 years after the independence. In Switzerland, women got the right to vote only in 1976, and so on. So it is an act of faith in one sense, and we are what I call India as a nation, it's a work in progress. And because that work in progress, because of the integration of states, 536 princely states merging with British India, you've got so many problems as a result of partition which has come about. This is all going to take its time. It's not easy. Whatever you want to do, it's going to take time. Now we've got, as I put it, a very strange situation where we have what I call as 600 million Indians are going to be in the school leaving age, I mean school going age, by 2015. And statistics show that by 2020, the average age of an Indian is 29. We'll be the second youngest country in the world. If you look at 600 million people, and assuming that what 10% of them drop out or pass out of school, you're looking at 60 million people wanting jobs. And if you're looking at, many of you are in the business, in the power sector business, there are many others who are looking at crime as a business because you have to invest very little. The chances of your succeeding are 90% because the rate of conviction is only about 10% in India. It's a very profitable business for people to go in. And therefore, for the next few decades, till as we grow up and we sort of are able to find jobs, skilled jobs, unskilled jobs, and the opportunities are huge today, you're going to find a lot of chaos on India's whole country. This is something for Indian democracy and the managers of Indian democracy. We have to manage this situation while this whole process takes place, because it's going to, I don't think we can give 60 million jobs every year. We are looking at, if you look at these studies, India's government's plans are to provide something like maximum of 12 million jobs a year. So which means you are only providing for 20%, and 80% of the people are going to be unemployed. And for them, crime is a very big business. And that is why you will find, whether it's mugging, whether it's chain snatching, whether it's theft, carjacking, name any number of professions, it's going to go up only. The rising crime rate in India, it's going to rise. The net result of this, which you're already seeing today, is that private security business is the fastest growing business in India today. The fastest growing, and it will grow at 20-30% annually, or even more, 50% every year, because you want CCTV cameras, you want all sorts of security gadgets to try and protect yourself, both individually, company-wise, and cities. That is really, in one sense, the challenge, how to make sure that you manage this situation while this whole internal process of churning takes place in India. The rising aspirations of the young. You've got a communication revolution, you've got IT revolution, and so on. They all want today, they want their mobile phones, they want their visit to the mall, they want a two-wheeler, they want a good life now. They're not willing to wait 30 years, 40 years, as perhaps we were willing to wait when we were young. We looked up, you know, you bought a second-hand car, then you went, you bought a second-hand car, and then you bought a new car, you know, 30 years later. Now the guy wants everything now. I'm not talking of just the upper middle class or even the lower middle class, I'm talking of even the poor. They are all wanting, they see what is available, and they think that they have an opportunity to take it in their lifetime, in the next decade, and so on. And that's going to be the real challenge for all of us as we move forward. I think we are really, I'm not really worried about, the terrorist threat from our neighboring countries. I think that is something which we will be able to manage. The real problem for us is, you know, people, I always keep saying, we lose 2,000 people a year due to Naxals in Jammu and Kashmir, all the northeastern states, 2,000 people are killed in a year. I lose 1,38,000 people in road accidents every year. 1,38,000, and nobody is bothered. I lose 30 lakh people every year who are injured in road accidents in India. And look at the loss to the economy. It's about $20 billion is what the WHO estimates. These 30 lakh people who have lost a limb, trauma, lost an eye, other minor injuries, and so on, every year. And that's a real colossal national waste, in one sense, if you want to put it. You also see, similar to that, in many areas, we are going to see, because of today's what I call as the IT revolution and so on, cyber security is going to be one of the fastest growing requirements today. I think the Institute of Defense Studies and Analysis has put out a task force report, which is on the website of IDSA, giving the entire scenarios and what would play out in the most extreme case as well as what is happening today. Today, if I talk, I'm not exaggerating, but right now, as I'm speaking, something like possibly over 250,000 computers are being hacked in India right now. And the information from all these 250,000 computers goes to 3 universities in China. Right now. We lose cybercrime. Reported and unreported, we lose now roughly, I think, about 16,000 crores per annum. That's the theft loss which is coming from cybercrime. And it's going to come bigger and bigger because we are trying to look at the UIDAI project. We are trying to look at mobile telephony, mobile banking, telephony banking, and so on. And so the opportunities and the possibilities for crime in this sector only go up in exponential terms. And we have to be extremely careful of the new dimensions of crime as they come up. Because this is going to be there, because whether we like it or not, and I've been one of the strongest proponents that when you have Facebook, you have Twitter, you have all these, and you get these type of, you've seen the Northeast people moving to their homes because of the threat messages and the fear that is created. This is only going to come up more and more in the years to come. And governments have to learn now to realize how to get onto this Facebook and Twitter to be able to counter it. In extreme emergency, you can block the entire internet, but you can't do it every time. Every time you have to be alert enough to be able to get your message onto it, because the youngsters are reading this all the time. And unless you are able to get your message also on Facebook, also on the internet, also on Twitter, they don't have anything else except these messages to come, and that is again a challenge for government. One of the big problems with the government which has come about is really lack of capacity. And it's astounding how in the last 20 years of economic liberalization, while the West has told India, downsize government, government is bad, privatize. And the Geeta Krishnan Committee on Expenditure Reforms said for every three posts, three people who retire, fill up one post and two posts are to be abolished. Has resulted today in really, in one sense, the capacity for us to govern and to implement some of these large projects, whether it's in NAREGA, whether it's your UMPP, whether it's your all these projects, capacity is very low. I estimate even just on internal security of the policeman shortage in all the states together, even at UN standards, it's something like between about 14 lakhs policemen you have to recruit every year. An additional 14 lakh policemen you have to recruit. It's not enough to recruit, I need to get them trained, and the training is abysmal. And that is why in the last few years, our basic focus has been, which I've been telling, we first focused on getting recruiting constables who get in on merit, not having to pay 75,000 rupees or a lakh and a half, his father having to sell his agricultural lands to get him a job as a constable. I can tell you, I think I've succeeded about, I think today 30% of India's police force is recruited possibly on merit now. It was about 10% a couple of years ago. We need to step that up to at least 80-90% and then 100%. Then training. Training is, unlike in the armed forces where training is considered almost, it's a prestige. If you are sent for a training, if you are sent for a training establishment in the army, it's considered that you have been selected to go rise above. In the police, it's not. If you're sent to a police training college, it means that you are in the doghouse. And I can just give you one simple example. In UP, when the Samajwadi Party won the elections after Mayawati lost the elections, what happened? Where did the DGP of Mayawati go? DGP training. And where did the new DGP come from? He was DGP training. And he was come back at DGP Law and Order. So mindset is, training is where I shunt out people I don't want, has its ripple effects down the force. I know in Jammu and Kashmir, people have would be surprised if I told you, there were four police training colleges which I visited, and it's supposed to be a frontline state against insurgency, terror, and so on and so forth. The total sanction strength in these four police training colleges in 2009 was zero. Have you ever heard of a police training college with the sanction strength zero? How did the police training college run? By attachment, which means from the neighboring districts and so on, people were sent, the DYSP was sent there, you are principal for 3 months, please go take charge, after 3 months you can go back. Somebody else will be posted as a principal, head constables are sent for 2 months, 2 weeks and so on, and you run a police training college, four police training colleges for years together. What kind of output will you have? These are key issues which have to be tackled. We've now slightly, they've come onto the center. We are slowly pushing some of these issues. Long way to go, But I think in one sense we are on the right track, but we need real push both in the center and the states, because police is a state subject, law and order is a state subject. We have to persuade the states. We are, as Devdutt put it, huge land of intense diversity. You have to take the states and the chief ministers and everybody along. Each have their own priorities. They have their own reasons for putting something on priority, and you have to take everybody along. But it's a great opportunity for us, and I see in the rural areas when I go, not only because I run a venture capital fund now which deals with startups, and I see the tremendous enthusiasm of the young. The young are far more optimistic about India than our TV channels are. If you read TV channels, you fall into depression if you watch them. But in the rural areas, let me tell you, there's not that much depression. People are looking forward to a good life. They see hope, they see a future for themselves, which is much better than what they had. And that, in one sense, is the real hope for us, that we're able to fulfill those aspirations as we move forward. But it's going to be a very hectic roller coaster ride for the next 3 decades at least. Thank you.
We have time, ladies and gentlemen. Actually, as per the program, we don't have time, but we can take 2 questions. So quickly, 2 questions, please, and then we'll move to the next. Mr. Dhol, can somebody give him, Mr. Dhol, the mic, please? And after you, yes, sir, I've seen you. Next.
Question is, how do you see securing infrastructure? My concern is energy infrastructure, transmission lines, substations, pipelines, fuel storage, ports, all of that, airports.
See, the infrastructure in one sense is the easiest to get. You know, get a police station built, provide them security, get them buildings and so on. You know, like left-wing extremist areas, we're giving 2 crores for a police station. That's the infrastructure part which possibly we'll be able to get it done. But the real hard part is getting the manpower, trained manpower. In fact, most policemen, and I would not be surprised if I say that, I think today 80 to 85% of policemen have no idea of policing. Forensic, no idea. Road accidents, and I'm just attending a recent seminar with all state police forces that come on road traffic accidents. Nobody investigates road accidents. They only look at, if you're a car, you hit a scooter, the car is at fault. Scooter hits a cyclist, the scooter is at fault. If a truck hits a car, the truck is at fault. He doesn't investigate at all. What are the reasons for the accident? Is it whose fault it is? Was the lighting adequate? Was the signage adequate? Was the roads properly? Nothing. And I can tell you that it's like one particular case I can tell you in Uttarakhand, we had road accidents and trucks falling off cars falling off the hillside into the valley below. And it was only a simple investigation when one of the road safety investigations, when you found out, it was just at that particular curve, there was an outhanging rock. So every car which was coming from this way, to miss that, they were coming onto the other side of the road. And another car was coming from that side, both were on the same side of the road, one fell off. And when we chopped off that overhanging on that curve, road accidents stopped. No accidents there for the last 1 year. That was something which a simple person who would have done road safety would have detected it in the first accident. But nobody bothers. If a truck fell down, if a car fell down, you treated it either he was drunk, he was over speeding or whatever it is, you found some reason. And you did no scientific investigation of the accidents. That is really the huge potential we have, because we are trying in the Home Ministry. We are now a lot of private sector. We have asked them to come for outsourcing police training itself, because we don't have people in the police training colleges to teach because of the huge shortage of manpower. And we are asking for long distance learning and very standard instructional classes to be now on the website, so that somebody can give us a DVD and we can put it in the classroom and all the constables and the sub-inspectors can learn.
Thanks. So one more question. The one behind Mrs. Jaitley, please. You raised your hand before, sir. That one, the gentleman there with glasses. Yeah, please give him the mic and then we'll wrap the session up. Otherwise, we can't keep to time.
Maruf?
You know, Ms. Pillai, you have seen very closely and you are still watching the administration, and I have seen political arena very, very closely. I'm sure you agree with me and what you just mentioned about terror and criminalization. I personally feel there is a very thin line between the two. And when you have parliament one-third, I don't even want to mention they are my colleagues, with hardcore criminal record. If you go to the website, their names and details are there. What I'm trying to ask you is on the Vohra Committee, for which I had gone to Supreme Court early 90s. And it talks all about how criminalization of politics and how the criminals have come to politics. As far as the political arena is concerned, I can tell you with all the responsibility under my command that today, even if you want to win an MLA election, you can't win unless and until you take the support of the local muscle man, call it mafia, call it criminal, call it anything. Now, Vohra Committee goes into the depth of it. Politics cannot survive with criminal today. Even if Dr. Manmohan Singh has to contest the election or Gandhiji has to contest the election, he will have to go to a criminal, otherwise it will be very difficult to win. And I'm telling you with personal experience. Now, my question is, isn't the bureaucracy thinking anything about it? Because politicians, they come and go. Bureaucracy is one solid foundation. When I ask people in IAS, they said, sir, what do? We are worried about our life. Is no longer worried about transfer. And I can tell you, we are sitting on a volcano. So if these guys are criminals, and if these unemployed guys are going to get into politics and get into criminalization, how long it takes for a neighboring country to pay these guys and put bomb wherever they want to do it. It's a very, very, very scary scenario. And I can tell you, I personally am terribly worried. I don't know what's your take on it and what could be the solution. I know it takes a long time for this question, but briefly.
No, I agree with you. I think it's a problem, but we have to tackle it in what I call certain fundamental ways. See, today, whether we like it or not, for politicians, the police force, irrespective of any party, it is a force which is to be used to further their political interests. That's across the country. That's the Now, how do we stop that or reduce the impact of that over a period of time? As I said, the first case I need to get is, I need to get people into the police force who are, shall I say, come in on merit. And I still believe that in today, at least from not only my experience, but in many others, people are willing, even politicians, are willing for you to exercise your rightful authority if they feel that you are fair. You must not have a vested interest your own. If you are fair, you're seen to be fair, you don't have any other, you know, angle or something to try and do a particular thing, I think the politicians, you know, in the service, I always used to say, even to my colleagues, I would always trust a politician rather than a senior officer. Because I would know that he would know, and I've gone to many a time when I'm in trouble in my hierarchy of, you know, disciplinary cases against me, the protection has actually come from the politicians and not from the senior officers. And that is something which, because in one sense, the politician has his ear to the ground. You know, it's a very hard life for a politician even otherwise. Forget about the criminal part of it. Even for a normal politician, it's a very hard life. The number of people who come to visit him, number of people who come with petitions and so on, is huge. It's a huge task which, you know, he has to do because people expect, somebody said, if you're a feudal country, people still, everybody comes up to the politician as Ma-Bap, and he has to, he can't say no because he goes back every 5 years to ask for votes and so on, and everybody looks back and says, did you help me or did you not help me? And that's a big issue. But I think some of these fundamental issues, if you are able to get your base correctly, get, see, nothing, I don't think any politician is stopping training of We've tried, even in UP last year, people are all worried about all the 18,000 people, not 18,000, I think about 30,000 constables who were recruited in UP. All of them got in without paying a single rupee. Thanks to the CM, but also thanks to an IG and a DIG who were really committed and made sure that this time we will make sure that nothing happens. I know in Rajasthan, members of parliament have come to me and said, thank you very much for making this transparent. Now nobody has come to us for any recommendation. So I think people are, there is an innate goodness in people. I think we need to really push that forward.
It's a very vast subject, ladies and gentlemen. We have to stay with time, otherwise, as it is, things are running completely out of control. Please give Mr. Pillai a good hand. He's done enormous justice to a subject which would take us ages to understand. Thank you very much, sir. May I now invite